Thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Division One Chair League action here. We have BJ and Co. versus Bang Bang. Both teams 0-3 this season, looking to get off the schneid and pick up their first win of Season 4 in Chair League here in Division One. Looks like both teams are in lobby, so hopefully we should be all good to go. Really like the fact that we have draft integration within client. It makes this so much easier. And we are officially starting the game, going into the draft, and we had a last minute addition to our lineup here today, so we're definitely going to be under the clock at 7:50. We have a Division II best of three series, and that will be the 85 DeLoreans versus FTS. Excited to cast that game. Got to play FTS a couple times last year. Good guys, good team, and of course 85 DeLorean. Have a couple of Chair League casters on there, Cavalier Guest and Haloran. Don't know exactly who's going to be playing on that team, but excited to cast it. BJ and Co. is first on the clock. Tomb of the Spider Queen. They have first ban. Looks like they're looking to ban the Ragnaros or Sylvanas, both of which are very good on this battlefield. Sylvanas just had so much pushing power to those Spider Queens. Can make this map even more snowbally than it is sometimes. Gul'dan is the response ban from Bang Bang, leaving Murky on the table. Murky currently sitting top of Hotslog's win rates, most certainly going to be hit with the nerf bat here sometime in the near future. A lot of good heroes on the board, of course. Murky, Arcanus, still very good. Malph, definitely the top support in the game, with the possible exception of Lucio, who's also very good. Kael'thas does excellent on Tomb of the Spider Queen, so we could certainly see him as well. 24 seconds left for BJ and Co. to make their first selection. Really thinking about it here. Well, we will see that pick here one way or the other very, very soon. And it will be Jaina. Jaina, first pick for BJ and Co. Great wave clear, great damage. Does a lot of zoning as well. Her main weakness is, of course, they're a small health pool and low on mobility. Coming back very quickly is Bang Bang with a Master Skin variant. I imagine we'll follow it up with some kind of CC, and we do. We get Malfurion. Varian is very prominent in organized hero play right now with his point and click charge, the stun into the taunt. You can set up so much with it. We're seeing it combined with Ragnaros' Sulfura Smash, Leeming combos. You could have it followed up with the root here on Malfurion. So he puts a lot of pressure on the enemy team to not get caught out and to make sure you get really good mileage out of that cleanse. Two picks for BJ and Co. I would be surprised if we didn't see the tank or the healer here, one of the two. Excuse me, ETC still on the board. Probably still one of the top tanks, well, probably definitely one of the top tanks in the game still. Johanna does great on Tomb of the Spider Queen as well, due to her wave clear. Dahaka, always good as well, also due to the wave clear. Not quite as much value out of his global on a smaller map like Tomb of the Spider Queen. And they do opt for their tank as well as Vala. So good auto attack damage for BJ and Co. out of Vala. Good ability damage out of Jaina, so nice variance in the damage types. And Diablo as their primary tank to really set up with the charge and the body slam. That leaves Bang Bang to ban, and they ban Rhaegar. They want to keep that bloodlust away from Vala. Makes a lot of sense there. And now BJ and Co. on the clock for their ban. I imagine we will see, I was going to say a tank. Yeah, they're going to go with ETC. Varian, or maybe the Leeming. I saw Jaina in there. They're certainly not going to go Jaina. So cycling through the entire Heroes roster, having no idea who they're going to ban, or they're just having a little fun with us. I was going to say, yeah, the Leeming ban makes sense. I said when they first picked Varian, Varian sets up Leeming so well, but Ragnaros is still on the board. I would not be shocked at all to see Bang Bang grab Ragnaros here. The Varian Sulfura Smash combo is very potent. Ragnaros has great wave clear, and the Molten Core, there's the Ragnaros selection. The Molten Core trait that Ragnaros has really stunts any kind of objective that can push. So on Tomb of the Spider Queen, where you have the Web Weavers pushing down the lanes, that Molten Core can really stunt that advance. And they follow up with a Tychus. So a nice core composition for Bang Bang, leaving that fifth pick as a flex pick. They could really do any number of things with that last pick. So we'll see if they have something sneaky they're going to sneak in there, or Murky still on the board, and we're seeing a whole lot of him right now. Back to BJ and Co. They still have not selected their support yet. Lucio is still on the board, so we could see him. That movement speed really gives a lot of trouble to the opposition, especially in the context of a team fight when Lucio's opponents are fleeing. They've lost the team fight and are trying to get away to live another day. That movement speed on Lucio can really mop up the back end of a team fight and turn a minor team victory into a major one. Would not be surprised to see Lucio. And they opt to go with Lieutenant Morales and Nazebo. So solo Diablo tank, triple range with Morales. And BJ and Co. has a ton of damage. Nazebo, Vala, and Jaina all do great damage. Nazebo scales really late too. Once Nazebo gets to 20, he gets to be even more of a terror. And Jaina and Nazebo offer great wave clear as well. I would wonder if we would see possibly something like maybe even a Valera here to put so much pressure on those backliners, or a Zeratul possibly. Maybe a second tank to combine with Varian, and they opt for the Greymane. That makes a lot of sense too. There's so many Vala, Morales, and Jaina in particular, squishy heroes that Greymane can get on if they're out of position or Diablo isn't there to peel Greymane off. That's a lot of squishy targets for that wolf to dive on. So good drafts by both sides. Obviously, anytime you have good teams in Division 1 like this in Chair League, it ultimately comes down to which team executes better. There's going to be a lot of pressure on Diablo to hold that front line all by himself against a Tychus and a Rag and a Varian. So interesting to see how this game goes. The wave clear advantage is definitely, I think, in favor of BJ and Co., especially with Varian, who does not bring a lot of wave clear to the table, pre-10 especially. So in the early game, if Bang Bang can keep up with the clearing pressure that's going to be put on them by BJ and Co., I think they'll be in a good spot. However, if they're constantly having to rotate and keep minions off of their buildings, they might not ever be able to take advantage of that lockdown combos that they have here. So the blue team, BJ and Co., we have Life with Savi on Diablo, Zentius on Vala, is that Gerudo King on Morales, Monferno on Nazebo, and Odin X on Jaina. The red team, Bang Bang, has Legacy on Malph, set by Sam, I'm going to say, on Tychus, Kronos on Ragnaros, Hebro on Varian, and Null on the Greymane. Both teams have grouped up in their parties of five and heading toward violence here in the middle lane. checking the bushes with our Guilnain cocktails and dancing around our gates, nobody stepping into the lane. The scouting drone for Morales, we're seeing more and more scouting drones lately with the increase in stealthies, and teams really discovering just how valuable that vision is. We're seeing more and more scouting drones. So it looks like Rag and Jaina will square off in the solo lane. The advantage there is definitely in Ragnaros' favor. Jaina will, I think, have a hard time in that. Not so much with the clear, but the self-sustain is in favor of Rag. And you can see he's already forced Jaina to tap and push this lane out. So if Rag can take advantage of that without getting picked off, that'll be a big win for Bang Bang. BJ and Co., on the other hand, looks like they're content to do a 1-3-1, while Bang Bang is doing a more traditional roving and clearing comp here. A little far forward from Vala, but Varian does not have his stun yet, so she was able to walk out of there. But Jaina 1v1's Ragnaros in the bottom lane, and just shows that this caster does not know what he was talking about. Ragnaros has the advantage. Odin X says otherwise and is able to get the solo kill. But now Greymane has rotated down and goes full Worgen on her. Poor Jaina never had a chance once Greymane got down there. A 1-for-1 train, both solo laners falling. Experience about even. Gems with a slight advantage to Bang Bang. Tomb of the Spider Queen can be a little bit snowbally. Once one team gets the turn in and controls the lane, sometimes it can be very difficult for the team that's behind to get a turn in and come back. I think BJ and Co. really wants to control this early lead, because this comp is going to come to life once Varian gets taunt. That's really what they're looking for. In the meantime, Bang Bang is just looking to buy time and keep this game close until they can get Varian as a full hero at 10. Varian, of course, very weak pre-10 before he gets his heroic and decides which way to go. I am, of course, assuming he will go taunt. I would be very surprised if he took any of the other heroics at 10. In the early game, Bang Bang is surprisingly controlling these rotations, and I think that's a symptom of the triple range that BJ and company has. It means the Vala and the Jaina are kind of trying to kite and play backwards, and that allows Bang Bang to control these rotations stronger. Greymane caught out a little bit, flipped and stunned. Follow up from Vala, he will Worgen away. Now Vala in trouble with Varian all over her. Lots of damage, no deaths, and back to the rotation we go. So 34 gems turned in. There's their stun and the root combo. That's exactly what Varian does. An excellent follow-up root by Legacy, allowing Null on Greymane to secure the kill on Morales. More pressure being put on BJ and Co. in the early game. There's the roots onto Nazebo, Greymane, Worgen, and the stun, and a ton of gems lost by Nazebo in the top lane. Early game strongly in favor of Bang Bang here, and they do have enough gems to secure the first turn-in of the game should they choose to, and that's exactly what they're doing. 8 short. I imagine Rag has most of those he will need to turn in. He does. Rag has 10 in the bottom lane, so they will need Rag to turn in if they want to secure it. And there he goes. Vala sniffed it out, missed the W, but did hit the Q. And now both teams rotating down to contest this bottom turn in. Diablo with low life being forced back, and Rag trying to turn in his 10 gems. His teammates trying to zone out for him, but Bang Bang is pushed off of the turn in, and they will reset and try for it again shortly. It looks like Ragnaros is going all the way to the top. There's the stun, there's the Greymane Worgen. Vala able to vault away, and Diablo with the follow-up counter engage, securing Greymane and Varian. Diablo, a one-man wrecking crew, isolating members of Bang Bang and allowing 2 kills to be secured. However, Ragnaros did get the turn in the meantime, and Red Web Weavers will be pushing down all 3 lanes momentarily. And both members of Bang Bang have spawned and will be here to take advantage of this turn. And looks like Rag will be pushing with the top lane. Top lane does get priority sometimes because this is the boss lane, and the boss is certainly one of the win conditions on Tomb of the Spider Queen. Four members of Bang Bang pushing hard in with the top lane Webweavers, and now five members with Varian showing up. Only two in defense. Now Vala rotating up three in defense for BJ and Co. But the top wall has fallen. The Webweaver is in good health. Now four members of BJ and Co. have responded. They really want to keep this fort up. Both of the other two Webweavers have been cleaned up. All three now going down. And they only have the front wall of this top lane to show for it. There's the stun and the Worgen onto Vala, and she will go down. That was my worry with BJ and Co's comp here, is with Jaina and Morales and Vala all susceptible to the Varian blow-up. And so far, Bang Bang has shown themselves to be adept with Null diving in right after Hebro on Varian, and they've secured a number of kills with the Varian stun. BJ and Co. does not quite have enough for turn in there. Oh, yes, they do. They do have enough for turn in, and they're trying to secure it. Bang Bang may be trying to win the race to level 10 and force them off. Both teams posturing around the turn in. Nazebo is in the top lane putting pressure, and now it looks like he will rotate down. Jaina is caught. She's in trouble. Greymane goes on, or the follow-up from Varian. That time they did it backwards. Greymane led the way, and Varian followed up. But the zombie wall's in a great spot, doing a ton of damage. Varian falls. The zombie wall setting it up, and there goes the Sulfurous Smash. Tens picked up by both teams. Two members of BJ and Co. Go down. However, the life bars on Bang Bang very low. They're forced to go back and tap, and once again, right back onto the battlefield. They do not want to let Blue get the turn in here, and there's the poke to prevent it again. So while we have a little lull here, let's go over these heroics. We have Jaina with Ring of Frost, Vala with Strafe, Morales with Stim Drone. I assume it will be going on to Vala, Diablo with Apoc, and Nazebo with, is that Gargantuan? With Ravenous Spirit. For the red team, Twilight Dream. For Malfurion, I believe we saw Sulfurous Smash from Rag, Commandeer Odin from Tychus, Go for the Throat from Greymane, and Taunt from Varian. While we were going over those heroics, Blue did secure their first turn in of the game, forcing Bang Bang to go into defense mode. There's the Varian and the Tychus. The zombie wall zoning them from behind, but Ravenous Spirit is going out. Morales will fall. Ring of Frost catches two. Strafe going out. Greymane so low. Varian so low. And Varian is the next to fall. A 1-4-1 trade. Tychus caught out a little far forward in his Commandeer Odin form. Now he moves back and is going to use the firepower of that ultimate to burn down the Webweaver. The top Webweaver, you can see here, not getting a whole lot of value because of how far that lane was pushed out. Molten Core used on the bottom. They're going to save this fort, and that's the value of Molten Core against any kind of pushing objective. This bottom Webweaver will accomplish very little. And actually, this whole turn-in has accomplished very little. Great defense by Bang Bang. However, this game is really neck and neck. 7-5, levels almost identical. Both teams with all forts up. I think there's going to be one big team fight. This could be it here. BJ and Co. a little forward. Varian's going to catch somebody, and he does. He catches Diablo. The taunt, the Sulfurous Smash. There goes Morales. Diablo is going to go next. Two members, BJ and Co., just overstayed their welcome a little bit too long. And a hard rotation by Bang Bang catches two members out. And Jaina, now far forward. I don't think she smells it coming. She figures Bang Bang going for the turn-in, but they are not. They are going for blood. Odin trying to get away. It is going to be close, but no. Now Jaina just has to buy time. She tries to be sneaky. Now it's only a matter of time. Ring of Frost does catch two, three, and a blizzard. So she does plenty of damage on her way out, but ultimately gets picked off. I imagine we will see Bang Bang's second turn-in coming momentarily. Ragnaros carrying around a small fortune with 32 gems. Blue team BJ and Co. trying to stall it out. They are still waiting for Jaina here, so a 5-on-4 in favor of Bang Bang here. Morale is so low, Greymane goes and finishes him off, but Diablo is able to take out Greymane on the backside. However, Nazebo and Vala fall, Diablo running for his life. A great root, and there goes Diablo, a 4-4-1 in favor of Bang Bang. So far, the fragile heroes just a little too vulnerable to the Greymane isolation with Varian, and it's to the tune of 14 kills in 11 minutes for BJ and Co. Still no turn in here. There, still no second turn in. I guess they're going to top off and return to the battlefield. And there is the turn in. They're still going to be too short. Now all members of BJ and Co. are up to stall if they want to. Bang Bang knows the time is on their side, though. And there's the turn in. And here comes their second Webweaver phase. With ammo low and walls down, this one is certain to do more damage than the first turn-in. They have secured a small level lead as well, 14-13. So here we go, 5-on-5 in the mid lane while they're waiting for the Webweavers to spawn. Apoc will be up in 7 seconds, as will Ravenous Spirit. In about 10 seconds, both teams will have their full complement of heroics. Only Commandeer Oda not available right now. It will be up in about 4 seconds. A hard push from Bang Bang into the mid fort. There's Commandeer Oda. And this is definitely a commitment. They want this mid fort to fall. In the meantime, the top Webweaver has taken down the top fort. Plenty of pressure on the bottom. There goes the Apoc. Ring of Frost catches 3. And there's Strafe and the taunt with the Ravenous Spirit. Bang Bang is in trouble right now. Malfurion, Rag, and Varian all fall to a very, very well-executed wombo combo with the Ring of Frost and the Apoc, followed up with the Ravenous Spirit and the Strafe. Tychus running for his life. Greymane doing everything he can to get him out of there, but the slows on Jaina. Cone of Cold gets her. And then a peeling grenade, not quite enough to save Jaina. A counter kill by Null on the Greymane. And the final tally of that team battle, 4-1 in favor of Bang Bang. However, they did get all 3 level 1 forts, and they secured a slight level lead as well. BJ and Co. currently controlling the early game, and neither team has a turn-in right now. I imagine they will back up, get some merc camps, reset, and continue to collect gems. BJ and Co., though, pretty close to their turn-in. And here's the merc camps that we anticipated. Blue team getting the bottom siege giants, while red team is getting their bruisers. Now we're going to see some posturing and maybe some picks. I really think in this roving team battle, though, the advantage goes to any team with Varian. Morales caught out, the stun, the taunt, the Greymane, and there goes Morales. Morales just can't be caught alone like that with the Varian comp and a number of gems lost for BJ and Co. I imagine Greymane here pretty soon will try to drop off his 20. You certainly don't want to get caught with that, with those on your person and killed. The execution, there's the taunt, the stun, there's the Ravenous Spirit though, and the Apoc counter initiate. Varian caught in Apoc, Ring of Frost, Ravenous Spirit, he goes down. Jaina gets away with less than 40 health. That was a great counter engage from BJ and Co. with Odin on Jaina, really living on the edge there. So still neither team having turn in, both teams trying to posture for said turn in. Both teams at level 7, the structural advantage though certainly in favor of Bang Bang. Both teams posturing, and it looks like BJ & Co. is going to take this bottom fort. It is very low. They just have to sneeze on it, and there it goes. In the meantime, Red will take the opportunity to turn in as many gems as they can. Greymane in particular really needed to get them off their body. And knowing that BJ & Co. is in the bottom lane, Bang Bang makes an aggressive boss call. With Greymane and Tychus, they should be able to burn this down pretty quick. It looks like BJ has an idea of what's going on here, but it is going to be too late. An aggressive boss call secured by Bang Bang. Varian goes in to stall the rotation. And here we go. BJ and Co. on the retreat. Bang Bang on the offensive, following the boss. They're going to try to push in with this. Without a turn in, this is their best opportunity to take full advantage. And the wall in this top keep is already down. So Bang Bang setting their sights on this top keep. Commandeer Odin goes out, and there goes the poke. A nice zoning zombie wall and blizzard there. There goes Ravenous Spirit on the back line, but Sulfurous Smash catches Jaina and Nazebo. And there's another good Ring of Frost, ton of damage, but there's the Molten Core to go out, and the Stun Swing catches a number of members of BJ & Co. Nazebo is the first to fall. Boss still going, but it won't be up too much longer. Diablo caught in the boss stun. Varian sends him in there, and now blue team in a ton of trouble. Top keep has gone down. Bang Bang has decided that discretion is the better part of valor, and with their low health bars, they will take their keep and go home. So almost all of the structures off the board currently for BJ & Co. Only two keeps left, while Bang Bang, on the verge of level 20, has only lost one fort. So they are certainly in control of this game right now. BJ & Co. will rotate and pick up their bruisers here, I would imagine. Bang Bang is going to clear out this bottom lane, hearth back for health and mana, make sure all of their resources are topped off for the next engagement. So BJ & Company is going to be trying to avoid their opponents until they pick up 20. Level 20s are imminent. For Bang Bang, they will get them momentarily, and there it is. Bang Bang is very close to getting their third turn in of the game. They're going to collect these giants here, and then I would imagine they will rotate maybe to their bruisers, or maybe they'll try to collect enough gems for another turn in, because they're very close. Currently sitting about 6 gems away, if my math is right. Blue was able to sneak in Nazebo, sneaking in the top lane and getting a turn in. That's not going to get much pressure onto Bang Bang, but it will relieve some of the pressure that's on the blue team right now, because they are definitely on their back foot under a ton of pressure, so that turn in will help alleviate some of that. However, with level 20 advantage, BJ & Co., I imagine, will clean these web weavers up in short order. Opting to play cautious without knowledge of where blue team is, Bang Bang decides to back up and defend at their fort, make sure they don't get caught in any kind of ambush or team engagement. BJ & Co. has shown that that Apoc Ring of Frost combo, when they utilize it, can be very potent. So Bang Bang being a little bit conservative here, making sure they don't get caught in any kind of trap or wombo combo. And both the mid and top web weavers have been cleaned up. Looks like BJ & Co. now with their level 20 trying to bush here. Maybe catch Bang Bang in rotation, but it is not to be. They are on their way to clear up the bottom web weavers. Red is certainly at an advantage here. They have all of their win conditions open for them. One team fight will win them this game. In the meantime, as soon as Bang Bang showed bottom, BJ & Co. put a lot of pressure on the top fort. However, with Commandeer Odin popped, they opt to simply back up and let Bang Bang burn that cooldown. So, a nice job of baiting out Commandeer Odin with the pressure in the top lane. However, Bang Bang does have turn in, and they're going to start posturing for that, I would imagine, very soon. Boss not a factor for another 30 seconds or so. That Commandeer Odin usage there might become a big factor, because it's not up for another 60 seconds, and it is the only heroic not currently on the board right now. And you never know when those types of things can come into effect in a game like this. A team fight win here for Bang Bang will seal their victory, while a team fight win for BJ and Co. will even this game out very quickly. BJ and Co. is posturing towards the boss. I don't think they're going to do it, but if they do, they are preventing the turn-in. So they are counter-engaging that. We have a bush party here. There's the cue to check. Odin is sniffed out. They are checking. They know that they're not on the boss because of Ragnaros. And now they have found the bush. Gilneas Cocktail. Good patience there by Bang Bang, not walking into the trap. Both teams now rotating away. They want their engagement. Commandeer Odin is now available, though, just coming off of cooldown. I think Bang Bang here is going to try to rotate down and get the turn in. It's going to be close. Nice Blizzard interrupt. They do get Greymane turned in, but that is it. Ragnaros still trying to turn in. Commandeer Odin is popped, and they are taking this engagement. They're going to use Tychus to zone away everybody while his teammates turn in. I would imagine there goes Greymane. There's the AoE and the Sulfurous Smash. Nobody dies except for Greymane to the Jaina combo and the Ring of Frost. Ice block to save herself, but she is going down anyway. And there goes Vala as well. Full retreat for BJ and Co. And Nazebo going to... I'm not even sure what took Nazebo out there. Oh, I think it was Rags. Rags AoE there. So three members down for BJ and Co. And Bang Bang looking to end the game. They're going to the top lane where there is no keep. Webweaver's pushing down. Only Diablo and Medic. There's the taunt onto the Medic. However, Diablo does zone him away. Caught in the root for his troubles. A ton of damage going out. Another stun onto Diablo. And there's the Molten Core. 20 seconds before Vala and Jaina will be up. I think they will have time to burn it down. This should be game. But if they don't, their damage dealers will be coming up with a full set of cooldowns to do some damage here. 50 seconds left. I'm sorry, 50%, 30%, 2 seconds till help up, and there goes the game. Bang Bang secures the win, their first win of the season, defeating BJ and company here in Division 1 Chair League. GG to both teams. Thanks for letting me cast, guys. We are running a little behind, so we are going to run right into our game 2, the 85 DeLoreans versus FSG. Hopefully they hung out and waited for me, because we're about 7 minutes behind game time. Let's see if they have started or not. Oh no, I did not mean to exit the game. Ah, I accidentally exited all the way out. Looks like they might still be waiting for me. Hopefully they are. I'm really excited to cast this game. This one should be a best of 3, Division 2. All right, hopefully we will... Hopefully they waited for us. Let's see. Yay, I think they did. Woo woo. All right, they have already started and are ready to go. I appreciate those guys waiting for me. Very excited to cast this one. All right, so we should be underway here momentarily. Game 1 will be on Sky Temple, and the 85 DeLoreans have first pick, first ban, which means FSG has chosen the map today. And we are going to jump right into this draft. Looks like both teams are here ready to go, so no downtime between games here. That's what we like to see. All right, here we are, right into the draft. And the overlay there is not correct. It is not picking up on this game, so we're going to delete that very quickly because it is not House of Chez versus Pharaoh Clan. It is 85 DeLoreans versus FSG. And it is 85 DeLoreans who have a first pick, first ban. They opt to ban Mouth. No problem, BJ. Thanks for being ready to go there so we could jump right into the game. I'm really stoked we didn't miss out on this one. Both Haloran and Cavalier Guest have casted my games many, many times, so pretty excited to be able to do theirs. FSG now on the clock for their first ban of the game. Really taking their time deciding which way they want to go. Ragnaros, of course, we saw his value in that last game. Maybe not quite as good on Sky Temple because there's no pushing objective for him to stall out, but he's just really good all of the time. We did not see Murky last game, but this is the era of Murky in Heroes of the Storm right now. He is still out there. They opt to ban Varian. We also saw how good Varian is with that point and click stun. It sets up so much damage and can really punish the opposition for bad positioning or being caught out. But going back to Murky, he doesn't, I don't think, has quite as much value in more organized type play. He's, I think, still fine, but he's so much better in like a solo type environment where he can just wreak havoc and it's not quite as organized and there's no comms. First pick to Haka for the 85 DeLoreans. Global is really, really solid on such a large battlefield like Sky Temple. His wave clear is excellent as well, of course. The tank meta in Heroes I actually think is in a pretty good spot right now. There's so many viable tanks. Dehaka certainly being one of them. FSG now has two selections to make. And they opt for ETC. And 10 seconds left approximately to make their second selection. ETC is always a good choice. He offers a great initiation, great peels. He can take his stage dive and talent into a global if he chooses. And speaking of globals, they follow up with a Falstad selection. Also a nice pick. The Gust is one of the most effective counters to Mosh Pit, so taking that away from the 85 DeLorean. I would imagine we will see Gust despite the buff to Hinterland's Blast. Gust is just so good, especially in an organized environment. It is absolutely a playmaker. Maybe see more of Hinterlands in solo queue, quick match type stuff, but I don't think we're going to see as much of it in organized play. 85 DeLoreans responding with Global Healer Brightwing and all-around Terror Ragnaros. The Varian Ragnaros combo is really solid, but you can accomplish a similar sort of thing if Dehaka can land his drag. You can use that to set up the Sulfurous Smash as well. And now double globals for the side of 85 DeLoreans. FSG choosing their second ban of this draft. maybe a backline damage dealer, or possibly a second tank, if 85 DeLoreans opts to go another tank, and instead they go to ban the Tassadar. Maybe they're thinking the 85 DeLoreans are going to pair Tassadar up as a second healer with Brightwing. 85 DeLoreans respond with a Rhaegar ban, trying to further isolate out that support role with Rhaegar off the board and Malfurion off the board, Brightwing Tassadar also off the board. I would not be surprised to see Lucio on the other side. He might be the best support left available. There is still Karazim, of course, as well. You have to wonder if FSG is going to leave their support for the last pick, knowing that he's not likely to be selected, or if they'll select it here and opt to leave their last pick as a response to whatever the 85 DeLoreans choose to do. Personally, I prefer to have flexibility in my last pick if I can. So I think we will see a support hero here and either another frontliner or a damage dealer of some sort. And they opt to leave their support for the end, picking a Zarya and a Kael'thas. So a second tank to fight alongside ETC, shields for the rest of the team, and of course Kael'thas' stun, damage, zoning, living bomb, phoenix, all of the above. So FSG's last pick will certainly be their support. 85 DeLoreans now making their last two selections. One of these is certainly going to be some kind of ranged damage dealer. Vala still on the board. And they could really do all kinds of things with that last one. So the ranged damage dealer is Gul'dan. And they opt to go double tank, triple melee with a Anub'arak, Ragnaros, Dahaka on the front line. Anub'arak, of course, can really soak up that Kael'thas damage with his dampened magic. And a ton of stuns. And two viable ultimates as well. They could use the Cahoon to isolate somebody out. Or, so certainly a support pick coming out for FSG. With currently only one melee hero to their roster, you could see a Karazim here possibly. I don't think we'll see an Uther, although he's still out there. Taran still out there, although she does struggle a little bit in the solo support role. 85 DeLoreans have done a nice job at isolating out this support class, and I really think it almost has to be a Lucio or Monk here. Let's see which way they go. And it is the Lucio. So we will see a Lucio today. One of the most frustrating things about playing against a Lucio is when you lose a team fight, that speed can really allow the other team to run you down. And it makes it difficult to disengage off of a lost team fight and can turn a minor team fight loss into a major one if you don't account for that speed boost that he offers to his teammates. So we are loading into Sky Temple. For the 85 DeLoreans, we will have Halorin on Dahaka, the Gentleman, aka Cavalier Guest, on Anub'arak, Sanch on Brightwing, Alathanis on Gul'dan, and Snaganez on Ragnaros. Well, I'm going to call him Snag because there's no way I'm going to pronounce that probably how it should be pronounced. And for FSG, we have Hiram on Kael'thas, Darklink on Falstan, Maul Bryan on ETC, Zazu on Zarya, and Neuroterran on Lucio. If you wish to live. This is a best of three, so we have at least one more game coming your way. This is Division 2 as well. My overlay is not functioning properly, so I will remind you periodically. It looks like all five members of the 85 DeLoreans are posturing in the bottom lane, maybe trying to get a little pressure and set up for that second temple phase. On Sky Temple, the first temples are always mid and top, and the second temple is always bottom. So if you can set your team up for success on on that second okay, we have a pause because our Brightwing unfortunately disconnected. What I started to say is that second temple phase really sets this game up. And if your team can set itself up for success by either taking out this bottom fountain, destroying the front wall, anything you can do to set yourself up for that second shrine, it is so important. So important for this battlefield. Both teams currently giving out their Twitter handles, so if you want to follow any of them, go ahead and check those out. We have to keep ourselves entertained somehow while we are in the pause waiting for Brightwing to join us back here in the Nexus. I do have a... Anytime you draft triple melee into Kael'thas, 85 DeLoreans are going to have to be really aware of their positioning so they don't spread that living bomb, because triple melee with the living bomb, if you don't mind your positioning and make sure not to spread it to the rest of your... make sure not to spread it to the rest of your team. So that's something that Haloran and Snag and the gentlemen are going to need to be aware of as the melee heroes on the front line here. So still waiting for Brightwing to come back. Haloran is saying he thinks we're ready to go. All right, we are all ready. Twitter handles have been given out. Everybody is following everybody else. Brightwing has been reconnected. The countdown has started, and off we go to game one. The DeLoreans leaving three members in the bottom lane, waiting to get some push here. Two of them global, so they can go wherever they want as soon as this is cleared out. It looks like Haloran will take the solo lane responsibly. Well, Snag on Rag caught a little bit far forward. Living bombs being spread, but everybody gets out safely. Snag with about half health. And then Dahaka doing his stuff, burrowing to the top lane where he will square off with Dark Link on the Falstad. So three members of the DeLorean staying in the mid. Brightwing is taking the bottom lane. Dahaka is taking the top. Body blocks onto ETC, taking a lot of poke damage. And he will escape, but he is being forced to hearth back already, and the timing could not have been better for the DeLoreans. So, first strategic question of the game for both of these teams is, are they going to leave somebody in the bottom lane? Currently, Brightwing and Zarya squaring off in the bottom lane. Brightwing, of course, can come up anytime she chooses. Zarya has no such luxury. The gentleman has taken this top... the mid shrine, steal the first couple of shots before being forced back, and now we have the 3-on-3 engagement here in the mid. Dahaka and Falstad continuing to square off in the top, but Snag eats a power slide and isolation, and he will fall. Now Zarya responding, forcing the DeLoreans back. Dahaka, in the meantime, taking this top fort, and the DeLoreans look like they're trying to split while Brightwing pushes here in the bottom lane. So all lanes being soaked by the DeLorean, both teams are securing a temple. Haloran, though, needs to be careful, and there's the push. He has popped his heal and his burrow. Will he get out alive? It's going to be close, but he does with about 300 hit points. He was able to secure many of the shots in the top. but not all. Even still, slight level lead here for the DeLoreans with that push here in the bottom. Strong rotation, though, from Kael Foss. Nope. They're doubling back around on Alathonis here, trying to catch him out. Gul'dan running for his life. There's the power slide and the gravity lapse. Living bomb and a hammer going down. He's running to Brightwing, who will help him get out alive. No harm done. About a half a level lead for the DeLoreans. The gentleman currently waiting for his burrow to come off of cooldown. I would imagine it's going to be close. There's the shield. There's Brightwing to try to keep him up, and he is able to escape safely. Only one kill so far. That was the pick in the mid lane by FSG. Nice job by Brightwing, and this is exactly what I highlighted during the pause. Getting that fountain is such a big deal. During the second temple phase, the DeLoreans will be at an advantage, able to tap the well, while the FSG players will not have that luxury. Looks like the DeLoreans rotating towards their siege giants. The gentleman anchoring for his team, making sure he doesn't get caught in an invasion there. Excuse me. FSG has gone. They have tapped. They want to make sure their resources are ready to go. Giants have been captured by the DeLoreans, and now a strong rotation onto the Bruisers. They are definitely playing the Mercs timing here a little bit better than FSG so far, and they have set themselves up, but there is a skirmish here. The gentleman trying to scout out if they're picking up their giants, stall it out, harassing, throwing out those spikes, while Brightwing is putting a ton of pressure on Zarya. She is forced to back out until her team comes to reinforce her. The gentleman probably going to be okay here. There's the burrow. He gets himself out safely. And just as the temple pops, the Bruisers are captured. So a tough strategic situation here for FSG. They have no fountain, and they have mercs pushing in the top. They're going to have to choose between responding to the mercs or contesting this bot temple. So they have opted to send Falstad up there. He will global down as soon as he clears out the mercs. But in the meantime, the DeLoreans will have the advantage for the second temple phase. Haloran burrowing right into the middle of everybody. He does get Lucio with the tongue, and down goes Lucio. Maul Brian on ETC in a terrible spot, running for his life. The polymorph, the corruption, and Kael Foss goes down on the backside to Gul'dan, although Zarya able to get ETC out safely. Strong early game here from the DeLoreans. They will certainly hit level 10 first and secure the entirety of this bottom shrine. All of that was really set up by this fountain capture, and the merc timing on the DeLoreans was really textbook there. Bottom fort is the first to fall. Falstad left early, this top pressure doing work as well. And now, with the level 10 advantage, the DeLoreans getting aggressive. They are trying to secure the boss before FSG gets level 10. They know that they're here, but no Falstad. There's the power slide, trying to isolate out a low-life Haloran. He pops his essence. He is healing up, and now he is burrowed. Boss still not leashed, and no 10s for FSG. This is a fight they really can't take, but they're trying to harass as much as possible. Maybe stall this out until they get 10. It's going to be close. And there's the Falstad. He does not have the gust, but the power slide and the face melt fighting without 10. However, the horrify was absolutely brutal, completely splitting FSG. And they decided to take that fight with pre-10. I think that they were hoping to get gust in right at the last minute. However, was not to be. A 3-for-nothing team fight in favor of the DeLoreans, and now they are pushing in hard. Zarya stunned by the gentleman, and here goes the boss pushing in the top keep walls. However, the globals for the DeLoreans in full effect. Brightwing is picking up this top fort, Dahaka picking up the bottom one, and full map control is here for the DeLoreans. Let's take a look at the level 10s while we have the chance. We have Reverse Amp for Lucio, Phoenix for Kael'thas, Mighty Gust for Falstad, Mosh Pit for ETC, and Expulsion Zone for Zarya. So a lot of boss control with the Expulsion Zone and the Mighty Gust. There's the Lucio speed boost in the top. Haloran very low, and he turns it, and they get Lucio with the damage over time anyway. The Gust unable to save him. For the DeLoreans, we have Adaptation for Dehaka, Locust Swarm for Anubarak, Emerald Wind for Brightwing, Horrify for Gul'dan, and Sulfurous Smash for Rhaegar. So both sides do have a ton of boss control. You have Horrify and Emerald Wind for the DeLoreans, and you have Mighty Gust and Expulsion Zone for Zarya. So these boss fights could get interesting. Thank you, Analog, for checking that out. I didn't think that was the case, but I was not 100% sure, so I appreciate you checking into that. Level 13 picked up by the DeLoreans, and they are getting aggressive, using the talent tier advantage to invade the Bruisers. FSG, not a whole lot they can do about it. They are now 3 levels down, effectively really about 2.5. Once again, trying for the invade. There's the Expulsion Zone, and it is a half a second too late. Haloran, however, in a ton of trouble. He is able to burrow out and gets the big heal. Lots of damage going out. So far, nobody has gone down except for Falstad, who eats a Sulfurous Smash. Great shot there by Snag to pick up the kill. And now, having secured the Bruisers and the kill onto Falstad, the DeLoreans content to back up and do a little bit of map control. Looks like Rag will go clear bottom and Gul'dan, while his teammates go secure the Bruisers in the top lane. FSG has a couple of times tried to fight with a talent tier disadvantage, and it just hasn't worked out for them. Currently 7-1 in favor of the DeLoreans. And you can see this mini-map. It is painted almost entirely blue. The globals and the Merc timing really allowing the DeLoreans to control the map and force FSG to move, respond to them, rather than the other way around. Good patience here by the DeLoreans. They're going to try to get 16. If they can get 16 here, they're still going to be 3 levels up, but Anubarak might be in no man's land here a little bit. Almost all of FSG is in the neighborhood. He does burrow out, but ETC with the power slide trying to isolate him out. Gul'dan has shown up to give him reinforcements, though. Anubarak is a pretty tough nut to pick off there, especially when you're down so far in level. So the first time in a while they have been on same talent tiers, but that will not last long. The DeLoreans on the verge of 16 and currently setting up a bush. There goes ETC setting up. There's the stun and the vulnerable and the horrify and the burrow. A good disengaging gust by Falstad, though, to hit the reset button on that. So 3 ultimates on cooldown for FSG, only horrify. Not available for the DeLoreans. Currently level 16 to 13. However, this could be a good invade with 2 members on the temple and all of FSG here. The DeLoreans could be in trouble. The Expulsion Zone isolates out Rag and Anub and the 2-man mosh pit. ETC still the first to go down. That level advantage is too much to overcome. Zarya goes down as well, as does Rag. So far, a 2-for-1 in favor of the DeLoreans. Anubarak on the pursuit, trying to catch Kael'thas. However, no dice. That was not a bad idea by FSG. They were able to catch 3 members to 5. However, that level disadvantage, just really too much to overcome. And I imagine we're going to see even more Merc control here by the DeLoreans, especially once Rag comes up. It'll be a 5-on-5. They have secured all of the bottom shrine here. And Dehaka going out on the map, going to apply even more pressure. FSG is grouping up. They want to make sure there's no boss here. However, seeing Dehaka in the top and knowing there are members down on the bottom, we have an aggressive rotation from FSG. And that is going to be five members on two. There goes Brightwing, caught out and destroyed. Brightwing went down fast. Alathanas on Gul'dan in a lot of trouble. That's that Lucio speed we were talking about. So a really hard, aggressive rotation from FSG. Good map awareness to know that they could catch members out. And they're trying for the boss call here. ETC anchoring, keeping the DeLoreans away. Aurify not here, Emerald Wind not here, so there's not a lot of options for the DeLoreans to contest this. I would be surprised if this boss did not go to FSG here. Nice gust to secure it, and this is what FSG needed to turn this game around right here. Going down the bottom lane, it will start to march toward the keep wall. Only two levels down now instead of three. So a nice turn here, and we do have another disconnect. Let's see if they call for a pause here, and we do. We lost ETC. That was a really, really nice rotation from FSG. An aggressive, calculated risk to catch two members of the DeLoreans on the shrine. They were able to kill both Brightwing and Gul'dan and take the boss. So this could be the swing that they need to get this game evened out, because so far it has been all the DeLoreans. They've been really playing puppet master on this map, controlling it with the mercs, controlling it with the Dahaka split push, Brightwing global, Dahaka global. And this is really the first time in this game that FSG has been able to force the DeLoreans to respond to something that they did. So that's a really good sign for them. They're also on the verge of hitting 16, so they will be on the same talent tier. And if you're going to try to fight down a level, this is when they want to do it, before 20 on the same talent tier. So fighting 16 into 18 will be their best chance at something close to a fair fight for FSG here. All right. Hopefully Mar O'Brien is coming back on ETC here shortly. Couple of DCs have plagued this game early. Lagif's getting thrown out. But it looks like ETC is back. They have called ready. And I imagine we will have a countdown here momentarily, and this game will be resumed. So when this game comes back, Dahaka is in the top lane, but he will be able to burrow down anytime to reinforce his team. Four members of the DeLoreans here to respond to the boss push, while all five members of FSG are here to push with the boss. They really want to try to get this keep if they can and even out this pressure in the bottom lane. There goes the rag on the Molten Core. A ton of poke damage. Zarya getting stunned and eating a lot of Gul'dan damage. That Molten Core on Ragnaros, so powerful, and just completely stunted the offense that FSG was trying to mount there. The only thing the DeLoreans will lose is the bottom keep wall. That is the power of Ragnaros' Molten Core. And in the meantime, Halorin on Dahaka pushed this wave all the way into the top keep. So map control still in favor of the DeLoreans. I would imagine we're going to try to see FSG pick a fight here. They want a fight before 20 is reached. Currently, they are on this mid-temple. They're going to, I would imagine, try to sniff out where the DeLoreans are going and invade, and that's what's happening. You can see FSG moving in the map. DeLoreans know this. They are ready, and we're going to have a big team fight here, flanked by ETC, but Zarya is caught by Halorin. Power slide in for the peel. So far, no damage. There's the Anub diving in. Zarya's taking a ton of damage, and another big Sulfurous Smash right on the Falstad. So much damage. Zarya went down very quickly, and FSG is going to have to retreat again. They had to take that fight before 20. Unfortunately, the Sulfurous Smash just did a ton of work. Cavalier Guest on the Gentleman diving in deep as Anubarak and really setting up that Sulfurous Smash and causing a ton of mayhem in the back line. Nice mosh pit with Kael'thas there to follow up. Brightwing does go down. The Gentleman running for his life. A nice counter engage by FSG. They knew they couldn't let both of these go to the DeLoreans. And now with two picks, FSG in a little bit of a better spot here. However, they're going to be under a lot of pressure the rest of this game with two keeps down. They have left ETC on the mid-temple, and now they are rotating hard to this top one to secure as many shots as they can. Snag is in trouble, and he will most certainly fall. So a nice counter engage there by FSG. They are able to get three kills, one of which is staggered from his teammates, and now they are moving in as a five-man to try to take advantage of this. Falstad is going to have to be goalkeeping, though, keeping the pressure off the core. So four men trying to secure a keep here. Brightwing and Anubarak will both be up shortly. However, no Ragnaros for Molten Core. He will not be up for another 30 seconds plus. Top keep wall has gone down, and FSG forced to retreat with Falstad not in attendance. They have to back up, content to take only the keep wall. So 20s have also been picked up for the DeLoreans. I think the FSG here is going to try to get some mercs and put some of the pressure back on to the DeLoreans and help maintain these lanes a little bit here. Boss not a factor for another minute. However, Dahaka goes right back to the top lane. He's going to continue to split push, get that pressure all over the map. The rest of the DeLoreans look like they will rotate bottom to try to clean up these giants. FSG, in the meantime, they appear to be going toward their bruisers, and they are. Both teams at level 20. It's interesting to see what ETC went death metal, so that's a potentially absolutely game-deciding talent at level 20 for ETC. So something we want to keep an eye on. Now, the DeLoreans here could choose to split these temples if they wanted. FSG has no such luxury, and with the vision there, ETC putting himself in position for death metal. You can see he's trying to set it up, and there it is. He walked right into the DeLoreans to try to set up that death metal. The Brightwing, however, used the Emerald Wind to negate as much of that lockdown as possible. The DeLoreans full attack mode. Kill ETC, kill Zarya. This should be game. It looks like rather than going to core personally, they're going to secure both of these temples, and I imagine that will probably be enough to end this game, although it will be close. FSG recognizes that, and the three surviving members are going to try to invade where Brightwing is. Brightwing could be in trouble. Falstad caught in the stun. The fly from Falstad to try to catch Brightwing. However, Anubarak and Dahaka have both shown up. Lucio caught in the drag from Haloran, however, able to skate very quickly away. And there goes game one. They really played that map like a fiddle, did the DeLoreans. And they take the first game in this best of three series. Really well played by them. The merc timing was just spot on. The use of the globals was really well done. And Snag was a sniper with that Sulfurous Smash. And his teammates setting him up for it too. Particularly Anubarak really diving into the middle of the enemy team to set up that Sulfurous Smash. Really well played by the DeLoreans there. FSG had a couple of moments where they were able to kind of claw back in that game, because in the middle of that game, they really looked to be down and out. However, a good strong rotation and a couple of picks, as well as a good counter engage late, left themselves in a better position to fight back. Ultimately, though, I think they just fell behind a little bit too far, and that last team fight really just sealed the deal and allowed the DeLoreans to capture game one victory. So now we are waiting for game two. Of course, that would mean it is the DeLoreans' choice of map. and FSG will be their first pick, first ban. One of the fun things about the best of three is watching the mid-game adjustments and seeing if you get targeted bans as the teams start to figure each other out a little bit. So curious to see if we see anything like that. Oh, maybe. Oh, there we go. There's the invite. So we are now on our way to game two, and it will be on Braxis Holdout is the selection of the 85 DeLoreans. Just waiting for FSG to make their way into this game. If FSG manages to take this game two, we will, of course, go to a deciding game three. If the DeLoreans take game two, they will, of course, secure the series and take the win for this week in Cheer League. I, unfortunately, have only had a chance to play one best of three this season, but I think it's really the way to go. It's a lot more fun. There's more strategy involved as you get to know the other team. Holy moly, that guy plays a killer Kerrigan. We can't let him get on that guy again. And it can really change the dynamics of the draft. In the best of one, the drafts tend to be, you know, a little bit meta, so it's a little easier to predict. But after you've played a team once or twice, if there's one player in particular that's killing you, those targeted bans can really change the dynamic of a draft. So now we're on Braxis Holdout, one of the newest maps for Heroes of the Storm. Two-lane map, and it really puts a lot of emphasis on holding down those satellite uplinks. So you'll see Morales has high value because she can healing beam somebody on to hold that point. Anybody that can stand on that point and just hold it down is more highly prioritized here. Rexxar, Gazlo, you've seen even Chen if there's light stuns on the opposition team, Johanna, Artanis. So it should be a good game. I imagine we're going to get this draft going here shortly. So it looks like both teams will be ready here soon. We're still making sure we all follow each other on Twitter. All right, so teams too busy bantering with one another to actually get this game started. All right, the R's have been thrown out, and this draft, I imagine somebody is going to hit a start button here any moment now. Hopefully we will have no DCs this time, no pauses, and we can just power this thing through. So, of course, this time, FSG has first pick, first ban. And Braxis, because of the dynamics of the map itself, sometimes you'll get some different bans. Ragnaros is really good on Braxis because the Molten Core can help stunt out the advance of the Zerg Rush. Also, he's great in the solo lane. Usually teams will send their solo laner to the top. And if you ever were to pick Lava Wave in an organized, more competitive type game, I suppose this would be the map for it. I still don't think we'll see it if somebody gets a hold of Ragnaros. The Sulfurous Smash is just too good if you can execute it. 10 seconds left before first ban for FSG here. And first ban will be Gul'dan. That's a great ban. One of the reasons why Gul'dan excels on Braxis is his AoE damage and wave clear is exceptional, of course. But you tend to have these long, drawn-out battles for these uplink positions. And Gul'dan is kind of self-sufficient. He can drain life off the minions and give himself mana back. So if he's played correctly, he doesn't ever really need to go back if you use him right. So he's very good on Braxis. The Delorean's responding with a Falstad ban, taking out the globals. Braxis Holdout is not a particularly large map. Generally on the smaller maps, the globals aren't as heavily prioritized. Braxis is kind of an exception though, because you need to rotate between the two points to hold them both at the same time. And just by the layout of the terrain, there's not a good direct path between them. So when you rotate, it takes longer than you think it would simply by the layout of the battlefield. And the first pick to Haka for FSG illustrates exactly what I was saying with the prioritized globals. And DeLoreans also, I said Morales is highly contested on this map because she can stick a healing beam on somebody and just have them hold that point. Zarya with her shields does the same thing. So with a Zarya Morales, FSG is going to be hard-pressed to push whoever is on that point off with the shields and the single target healing beam. Two picks now for FSG. I imagine we'll see some kind of high wave clear hero in this rotation, Kael'thas or Ragnaros. So there's the Ragnaros Varian combo we're seeing a lot, which is the stun and the taunt into the Sulfurous Smash is just brutal. 85 DeLoreans on the clock for their mid-draft ban. I apologize, I'm still getting over a little bit of a cold, so my throat not 100% yet. I would imagine we will see a support ban, and there's the Lucio ban. Malph is still on the board. I would imagine that's who FSG will end up with is the Malph, which is fine. Malph is great. The roots will really add to all of the hard CC that FSG already has. Stun, drag, root. So they'll have a lot of ways to lock down somebody on the side of FSG, assuming that they draft that Malph, and I can't see any reason why they wouldn't. I mean, that ban for the DeLoreans was essentially, do we want them to get Lucio or do we want them to get Malph, and they chose to keep Malph available. Vala ban for the side of FSG. Vala is just an all-around great damage dealer, and especially anytime she gets shields, it allows whoever is playing that Vala to go a little bit ham. So in this case, if they chose to have Zarya shield that Vala, it allows her to get aggressive and really do a lot more damage than she would otherwise, because the shields allow her to be more aggressive with her positioning. Because that those shields eliminate Vala's biggest weakness, of course, is a small health pool. And she would be particularly vulnerable to the Varian stun Ragnaros combo, and that would leave a lot of pressure on Zarya to shield her out of it, but no Vala, so that's not something we need to worry about. I would imagine we'll see probably their primary tank here, or not. We're going Sonya, Kael'thas. Kael'thas is great on here, and Sonya with a Morales on her and the spin sustain, she's in a great spot right now, and with so much to spin off of and heal herself, she can really be a nightmare too. Bring down. Now, Varian stun, of course, can take her out of that, as can the drag, so whoever the Sonya player will be just needs to be careful of the hard CC. Last two picks for FSG. I would be surprised if we didn't see Malph, and there it is. And now their last pick. Some kind of range damage, I would suspect. Maybe AoE damage. Jaina's still out there if they wanted to go a mage. Li Ming is not one of her great maps, but she's still good, especially when you have a Varian setting up her damage. So could see a Li Ming theoretically. And it's Jaina. So a nice kind of traditional, well-balanced comp for FSG. A nice big front line for Jaina to hide behind. And two great solo laners. They could either send Rag or Dahaka to the top lane. Last pick, Hammer. Very interesting comp for the DeLoreans. They don't have what you would typically think of as a main tank. Usually you're going to see a Muradin or a ETC who wasn't drafted or banned this game. But instead opting for a front line of Zarya and Sonya, and going for the "we're going to do a ton of damage to you" route. So I'm very interesting to see how this plays out. Hammer can be an absolute nightmare to deal with, especially with a Morales if you can't get to her. So for the DeLoreans, Halorin will be playing Sonya, the Gentleman on Zarya, Sanch on Morales, Alathanas on Kael'thas, and Snag on Sergeant Hammer. For FSG, Mar Bryan on Dahaka, Zazu on Varian, Hiram on Jaina, Dark Link on Ragnaros, and Neuroterran on the Malfurion. It's always fun to cast when you get kind of non-traditional comps like the DeLoreans are running here. So really interested to see how this plays out. I imagine Sonya will be the solo laner, and then either Rag or Dahaka will be the solo laner for FSG. So it looks like it'll be Dahaka soloing for... Can we remake? Systems online. Interesting. We might be remaking this game, apparently, because the Gentleman... Oh, yeah, that is awkward. Cavalier Guest, a.k.a. the Gentleman, is supposed to be casting the HGC Open right now, and the second semi was really short, so it looks like the DeLoreans here, we're going to have to remake and get their sub in here. Assuming FSG is good with it, I don't know why they would be. Alright. So we are all leaving this game and we will be remaking without the Gentleman, aka Cavalier Guest, in this game. He is off to cast the third place game of the HGC Open. So we will await our invite to the new lobby. So a lot of this game, how it's going to play out, is going to be if FSG can get to and put pressure on that Hammer. If Hammer is just allowed to sit there and, you know, blow everything up in siege mode, it's going to be a long game for FSG. So they have to make sure that they put pressure on that Hammer. The advantage that FSG has is going to be the Dahaka Global, being able to bounce between lanes. And, of course, Ragnaros and his Molten Core, the ability to defend that Zerg Rush to blunt that Zerg advantage. So we have Nikita filling in here for the Gentleman. Change. both teams now picking their comps. We, of course, don't need to redraft because that's already happened. So everyone's just going to go ahead and pick their heroes, and off we will go. Six out of ten players ready. We will be on the road again here very shortly. And we have officially started. So countdown has begun. And we are on to the loading screen. So, take two of game two. This time, Haloran will be on Zarya, Sunk on Lieutenant Morales, Alathanas on Kael'thas, Snag on Sergeant Hammer, and our new player, Nikita, on Sonya. For FSG, Maul O'Brien on Dahaka, Hiram on Jaina, Darklink on Ragnaros, Neuroterran on Malfurion, and Zazu. Zazu? No. Zazu. Yeah, Zazu. Varian. All right, so once again, I would imagine Sonya will be taking the top lane for the DeLoreans, and based on what happened last game, Dahaka will be soloing the top lane for FSG. That should be a pretty even fight, I imagine, if both players play it well. Well, Morales has DC'd, so we are beset by technical issues. Let's see what happens. Oh, he is back. Okay, he's back. So I don't think we're going to need a pause here. Just a little bit of a hiccup there, a little lag, if you will. So, I imagine the DeLoreans were going to try to take advantage of the early game Varian. Varian, of course, is a little weak before 10. He doesn't really get his complete kit until he gets his heroics at 10. And he will most certainly be going taunt, of course, to set up that Sulfurous Smash and Jaina. Both teams posturing around for position in this top lane. I think the DeLoreans will slowly win out over here in the early game. Let's take a peek in the top lane. Maul O'Brien looks like he's getting the best of Sonya. He might be saving his drag for her spin to win. But I don't think neither Eero hero has a significant advantage over the other. Dahaka's wave clear is probably a little bit better than Sonya's, but not much going to be going on there. In the meantime, the DeLoreans have pushed in to the wall. Varian very low. Great gravity lapse by Alathanas and good follow-up from his team. And now Hammer is in position and the rest of his team there to zone out for him. He is unsieged and backed up. Haloran eating the blizzard to get full energy. When Zarya is at full energy, she does a lot of damage. That's one of the keys to being a good Zarya player is energy management. If you can keep that energy up high, you can do a lot of damage. So pressure being put on the front wall here of FSG. In the top lane, it looks like Dahaka is winning this a little bit, but not hard. There's a three-man route and a dive from Varian, but nothing doing there. Shields coming out. Now Varian in a lot of trouble. The gravity lapse misses, allowing Zazu on Varian to escape with his life, and he will be hearthing back. A popped Molten Core for the poke, really trying to relieve the pressure that the DeLoreans are putting on here. But Sonya takes the top lane, forced Dahaka to hearth back. So that's a big early victory here for the DeLoreans. Currently at 38% of the Zerg wave. Oh, hi. Hi. The DeLoreans still holding on to the top lane, or to both beacons. And they are very close to a 100-0 Zerg rush, and they have secured it. Or have they? No, Dahaka takes it out just in time. 98% currently for the DeLoreans. They are in a great spot here. And when that Zerg wave does appear, it will be pushing for the DeLoreans in the top lane and pushing for FSG in the bot lane. So despite the early game success of FSG, I'm sorry, of the DeLoreans, FSG still fighting hard. And Dehaka is able to solo Sonya in the bottom lane. That's a big win for Maul Bryan on Dehaka. Not able to secure both, though. Alathanas on Kael'thas has rotated to the top to keep the soak up. But that leaves a 4-on-3. Dehaka has burrowed down. They are now securing both. But with Dehaka visible, only 2% secured by FSG. Really nice rotations from the DeLoreans to not lose too much with that Sonya death. And now Sonya and Kael'thas in the top. And I think Alathanas on Kael'thas. Yes, he will rotate bottom. He is coming down right now. There's the root and a blizzard. Full blizzard on a hammer. Halorin in trouble too. Morales healing beam is on him though. We'll keep him up. So a great root by Neuroterran to secure the kill onto Hammer. That blizzard getting full value dropped right on top of that root. FSG now controlling the bottom lane a little bit with the kills that they got on Sonya and then on Hammer. Still though, 98% in favor of the DeLoreans. They are in no rush right now. Morales too far forward. There's the stun, there's the root, there's the blizzard, and down she goes. Morales a little too far forward, but Hammer is set up, doing damage. They cannot seem, the DeLoreans, to get their four-man back together again and secure this bottom. Trib, now the rotation onto top. It looks like they're going to try to catch Dehaka or just secure this top. Yeah, they want to make sure that they do not lose both tributes there. Halorin left by himself in the bottom to maintain soak down here. The DeLoreans on their back foot with the three kills. First Sonya, and then Hammer, and then Morales. But back on the offensive they go. All four members back. Hammer is zoning out the members of FSG. There's the root stun blizzard combo again. This time, though, they were ready for it. The healing beam is out. The shields are out. And Sonya traded her life for the 100 to 60 or so Zerg wave here. So not a small Zerg wave for FSG, but a 100 Zerg wave for the DeLoreans. It looks like Morales and Halorin will be left to defend this bottom while three members are pushing. Meanwhile, in the top, Hammer sieged up and doing work. There's the Rag. This is the advantage of Rag. This is what allows them to keep only two people in lane to defend this, is because the Rag Molten Core can really do a ton of work. In the meantime, FSG has secured this fort and forced four members of the DeLoreans to respawn. So despite the superior Zerg wave, the power of Dehaka actually allowed that trade to be favorable to FSG. They're on the verge of picking up their heroics, and DeLoreans have lost the bottom fort. So now we go to that time between the shrines where both teams will more than likely pick up their merc camps. And here we go. Strong presence in the bottom lane here from FSG. And both teams kind of posturing. Thank you. Both teams posturing for their merc camps and into lanes. FSG has settled with Dehaka as the solo laner. Sonya, in the meantime, is soloing this merc camp while the DeLoreans kind of get back on their footing, I guess, here. An invasion from FSG with their heroics. The DeLoreans in a tight spot. They do secure it, but a Ring of Frost will absolutely blow up Sonya. Halorin caught out. stunned and taunted. Great aggressive invasion from FSG, and they are able to take out Zarya and Sonya, and now they will attack the boss. So just as the DeLoreans controlled the early going in game one, FSG have rebounded and are now controlling the early going here in game two. They have secured their level 10s, they have secured the boss, and they are looking in fine shape here 8 minutes in. We have Ring of Frost for Jaina. I believe that's adaptation for... It is for Dahaka. Sulfurous Smash for Ragnaros. Twilight Dream for Malfurion. And of course, Taunt for Varian. All five members of FSG here in the top lane pushing with the boss, trying to get the DeLorean's second fort of the game. There's the stun taunt. There's the Sulfurous Smash. Haloran on Zarya taking a lot of damage, able to shield himself, and with the Healing Beam, almost able to get out, but not quite. Stim Drone Hammer going a little crazy, but there is Molten Core, and that forces a full retreat from the DeLoreans and a nearly full health boss still on the prowl. FSG has secured the first fort, and they are looking for more. They have obliterated the top keep walls here, and the retreat ping's coming out for FSG. They are content to secure that keep wall, and that's a big deal because FSG's Zerg Wave will be pushing in the top lane straight to that keep. They rotated back quickly. Jaina might be cut out, though. She is running for her life on her green lion or wolf. Sonya, in the meantime, caught out in the bottom, and once again the DeLoreans on their back foot here in game two. I was really curious to see how they would run it with a kind of a no pure tank. FSG securing the point, and they are well on their way to a large Zerg wave here. All members now up for the DeLoreans, and let's see where they will make their next move. They appear to be grouping in the bottom lane while FSG is bushing in the top lane. So a 100-0 Zerg wave in favor of FSG. This top keep is certainly in peril. Talent tier advantage, Zerg advantage. FSG in control right now. All five members present and accounted for, both teams, and the Zerg wave now crashing into this top keep. A Stim Drone Hammer doing everything it can to clear it. They're doing a zone honor, but there's the Sulfurous Smash, the Taunt, the Ring of Frost casting two members. Zarya, the first to go. Hammer will go shortly after that. And there goes Sonya with all five members of FSG up. You wonder how far they're going to try and push it. Their health bars are pretty low. I don't think they'll go too much further past this top keep. And yeah, they're opting to back up. It's too early for a core call with the short death timers and their health bars too low to go any further than that. But level 15 currently to level 11. FSG really controlling game two. And unless the DeLoreans make a spectacular play here, I think we're going to go to a game three the way this is looking. Aggressive invasion by FSG, but those are the kinds of things that you can afford to do when you're up three levels and a talent tier. So it looks like they will be invading one more time, just waiting for their full members. Yep, once again, FSG will be invading. The DeLoreans know there's not much they can do to stop them. This map is colored red in its entirety. The DeLoreans forced retreat. They will be pushed back into their base for the foreseeable future while FSG gets Merc Camp after Merc Camp. And the boss coming up now, I think they're going to try to bait boss with a party bush here. The DeLoreans deciding if they're going to contest boss or not. They are not contesting boss. They are opting instead to clear this top Merc Camp. FSG, sensing the advantage, is going to try to take out this keep wall in the bottom lane. Really playing the map well by FSG, showing no ill effects of that game one defeat. They do take out both towers, nearly the entirety of the front wall of the bottom keep, and then retreat. They're now up 2 talent tiers, level 13, not yet acquired by the DeLoreans. Continuing to get the Merc camps, there's pressure all over this map. The DeLoreans really in a rough spot here. I'm a little surprised that FSG hasn't made a boss play quite yet with the advantage that they have. I think they're trying to bait them in here, but so far the DeLoreans haven't bit. 2 Merc camps will now be pressured in the bottom lane. The DeLoreans are going to have to make a move. FSG knows that, and they're just waiting for them to reveal themselves. Both satellite links captured. The DeLoreans will take top and stall out this Zerg wave. FSG showing patience. They know that as soon as they show in the bottom, they can tank this. Sonya taunted, stunned. There's the Ring of Frost, catches 3 members. Nobody dead yet, though, but there goes Kael'thas. There goes Morales. There goes Sonya. There goes Zarya. Hammer, the only one alive to tell the tale. This will be, once again, another 100-0 Merc wave. And I think FSG posturing to end right here. There's the stun. There's the taunt. There's the root. There's the blizzard. And Hammer now not alive anymore. They will have 4 members here to defend as Zarya, Morales, Kael'thas, Sonya all spawning imminently. However, 4 levels down with a Molten Core and a 100-0 Zerg wave spawning soon. Things are desperate for the DeLoreans. Sonya gets taken out. There goes Kael'thas, and game 2 is going to go to FSG. A pretty dominant showing. Certainly no morale loss there from that game 1 loss, and we will have a game 3 in what's been a really fun series. Pretty dominant performance by FSG. They played really, really well. So we will have a game 3 in this best of 3 series versus the 85 DeLoreans versus FSG. Once they got going there, they just did not let control of that game fall away from them. Some staggered deaths in the early laning phase, and they snowballed it into a big-time win. Game 3, map battlefield will be chosen by FSG, and the DeLoreans will have first ban, first pick. Just waiting on the invite for the lobby. Once again, Ragnaros showed that game why he so heavily prioritized the Molten Core is just too good. And when you land that Sulfurous Smash, it just does so much damage. And despite that, he's made it through the ban phases in both Game 1 and Game 2. And both games, it was the Ragnaros team that won, so we'll see if he gets banned this time or if he makes it through for some more Ragnaros play here. A little Mario Kart reference there. FSG calling for Rainbow Road Battlefield this time. So waiting for our game 3, it looks like FSG is still contemplating the map that they will choose. Okay, 1 cup of tea, then it's time for bed, okay? For our decisive game 3. Battlefield. So it looks like we're going to go to Battlefield of Eternity. This is another Battlefield that, kind of like Braxis, that has some, that has its kind of own more unique meta. You'll see more gray mains here. This is the map you're most likely to see Tyrande on due to the Hunter's Mark. So, also a two-lane map. Global's less prioritized on this battlefield than others, where split pushing is less of a thing, and you really tend to be focused on the objective. So, might see some different comps here on Battlefield of Eternity for that reason. Single target DPS is the name of the game if you want to burn down that Immortal. Vala excels at that. I mentioned Greymane does as well. Li Ming is probably the best hero for being able to poke out the Immortal when it's on the opposition side of the map. She can really burn it down quickly. So Li Ming is great on this map as well. Looks like Haloran has created the lobby, and there's my invite, so we will be going soon. Just waiting on one more member of the 85 DeLoreans. And then we'll get this show on the road. And there he is. He's back. So I imagine this will be started very shortly here. Just got to make sure each team has their team captain selected to handle the draft. And then we get our decisive, epic game three of this best of three Division II series. 85 DeLoreans. Versus FTS. All right, draft has officially begun. And the DeLoreans are on the clock officially for their first ban. You know, how these drafts have gone really illustrates the difference between a solo experience that most hero players play, like Solo Hero League, and an organized team play. First ban, Malph, for the DeLoreans after briefly considering Rag. And that's Murky is currently crushing it all over Heroes in Solo Hero League, and he has not been picked or banned in any of these series, just because he's easier to deal with in a more organized setting. Whereas in the kind of more random, loosey-goosey, chaotic nature of Solo Hero League, Murky can really sow chaos and wreck a game. Red team now, their first ban of the game. And they ban Artanis. Artanis is excellent on Battlefield because he has the amateur opponent, the single target damage on the Immortal. Also, his swap is, it can be really game-breaking. You can start a 5-on-4 even before the battle starts. So we haven't seen him yet today in this series. However, we will see him only in the form of a ban in Game 3 here. 85 DeLoreans now have their first pick. Could see Vala is really a strong hero on Battlefield of Eternity. Could see Li Ming as well. Greymane you see here, as I mentioned. And instead they go Varian. He is really all over the place in any kind of organized environment just because he locks somebody down for so long and it sets your team to just blow them up. So there's the Leeming selection that I highlighted before the draft started. Her single target damage is so good, and the fact that she can do it from so far away means that whenever her team has the Immortal on the defensive side, her long-range poke forces her opposition to react to that. So that's one of the reasons you see Leeming on Battlefield of Eternity, maybe more than any other battlefield. Second pick, really debating the second one. 3 seconds left, so we'll see it here very soon. Second pick is Tassadar. So we haven't seen him other than a ban earlier, but that Tassadar can set up Vala. It can set up Greymane. You can see Tassadar Zul'jin. So there's so many heroes that pair with Tassadar so well. Illidan as well. However, now Varian does have his shield breaker at 13. So he gets the counter to Tassadar a little bit earlier, and that shield breaker will eat through that Tassadar shield lickety-split. So the early game advantage will go to red. However, if they get to 13, that Varian shield breaker can certainly flip the script very quickly in favor of the DeLoreans. Ragnaros still on the board for Varian Sulfura Smash. I wouldn't be surprised to see a Varian. I also wouldn't be surprised to see a Vala take it away. And there it is, Vala Ragnaros. So I'm glad it looks like I know what I'm talking about there. Vala is always a good selection, but I'm sure at least part of the reason for that draft selection was to keep them away from Tassadar, and that allows them to use that ban for something else. Red now on the clock for their mid-draft ban. Probably we'll see a support ban out, I would guess. Really, really discussing this ban. Maybe a Lucio ban, maybe Taronda ban. Not sure which way they go. They do go with the Zarya. So they're keeping the shields away from Vala, which makes a lot of sense. Just like the DeLoreans kept Vala away from the shields, now they are responding in kind by keeping the shields away from Vala. You'll probably see a tank ban coming out from the DeLoreans. ETC is still on the board. I think a Johanna or Muradin ban is a little less likely. I think you're probably going to see maybe a Dahaka or an ETC ban here. Or possibly somebody that they're worried about pairing with that Tassadar. So a Zul'jin pairs with Tassadar nicely, or Greymane pairs with him nicely. And Greymane is also just excellent on Battlefield of Eternity as well. So good ban there by the DeLoreans. Red now on the clock for their two selections here. They go with Karazim, someone we haven't seen yet. Partially, I'm sure, for the single target damage and ETC. So tank and healer. So double support with Karazim Tassadar. And I imagine that last slot could be another frontliner, like maybe a Sonya could also be a ranged damage dealer. I've mentioned Zul'jin a couple times. Lunara, you don't see much of her, but she does excel on Battlefield of Eternity. Does solid damage as well. She might be a little squishy to put in a game with a Varian Ragnaros, though. You'd have to be very careful with her positioning. Last two picks to round out the roster for the 85 DeLoreans. We're going to see a support hero come out of some sort. I think it's going to be Rhaegar. Bloodlust Vala is really good. Ancestral also good as well. So I think we're going to see a Rhaegar come out. and then probably some other damage dealer. And Rhaegar Falstad. So there's the Falstad Global. Of course, with Gust as well. He's never a bad hero. Wow.
Yep.
All right, so last pick here for Red to round out their comp. They already have the tank. They already have their supports. So, I mean, any number of heroes could be selected here. Very interested to see how they round this out. I would, if I were to guess, some kind of auto attacker to complement Li Ming, so you're not so ability damage based. Sonya. All right, so a second frontliner. I did mention Sonya earlier. She's in a good spot, too. So both teams now swapping if need be, and they and we will be off to game number three, decisive game number three to decide the winner of this Division II matchup. So for the 85 DeLoreans, we will have Halorin on Varian, Nikita on Vala, Alathanas on Falstad, Snag on Ragnaros one more time, and Sanch on Rhaegar. For FSG, Marl Bryan on Sonya, Darklink on Li Ming, Neuroterran on Tassadar, Hiram on Karazim, and Zazu on ETC. So despite having Vala, I think in a straight up race, Red has a little bit of an advantage between Karazim, Li Ming, and Sonya. It would be close though. Li Ming will almost assuredly go Q build on Battlefield of Eternity. The Q build gets so much value on here. So Ragnaros will take the solo top lane for the 85 DeLoreans, and Sonya Tassadar duoing the bottom, while the remaining members of Red go to the bottom lane. So Ragnaros is a good solo laner amongst all his other solid heroic attributes. And I take it back. So Sonya will be soloing the top, and all the members of each of the other team will be heading bot. And it looks like Vala is indeed going the Q build. Both teams posturing in the bottom. Halorin and Alathana see a nice orb combo from Darklink. I think Rag will probably have a slight advantage in the top lane. There's the initiation past Vala. Not a lot of follow-up on that there, though. Just a lot of poke from both sides. These long, drawn-out battles, though, I think will favor the double support over just the healing of Rhaegar. So it looks like in the top lane, it's a pretty even matchup. Both heroes a little bit low on life. Neither one pushing out the lane at all. In the bottom, the DeLorean's going a little bit, being pushed back just a little bit. That might be a reflection of the weak Varian early game, because as we've mentioned in all of these battles leading up to this game 3, Varian is one of the weakest early heroes in the game. He gets a big power spike at 4 with his stun, and of course a bigger power spike at 10. But pre-4, he's very weak, and pre-10, not much better. So now we have the first immortal spawning, and if you don't know, the first immortal always spawns one bottom and one top, and after halftime, it always goes to the opponent's side, allowing you to burn it down quicker. In the top lane, Sonya and Rag still squaring off. Blue has gotten their early lead, the DeLoreans putting damage on there. However, they were simply waiting for reinforcements. Helorin on Varian caught out, and he will go down. Monk is very low on life. However, early advantage goes over to FSG. Sonya now going to DPS the 85 DeLoreans immortal while the rest defend, being forced back by Alathanas and Sanchon Rhaegar. So teams continue to posture around the immortals. They're at almost identical life. Once again, Sonya starting to DPS the blue immortal. And the DeLoreans responding in kind, aggressively taking out. And now it looks like both teams will settle in for a race. And it looks like the DeLoreans are winning that race. So DeLoreans do... I'm sorry, I take it back. Red FSG wins halftime. And they're not opting to burn it. Instead, they're defending theirs. That's not what I would expect. And now all members here for a 5-on-5. Maybe they want to take advantage of that early game Varian while they can. They're really forcing the DeLoreans back. A 4-man power slide. Helorin goes down once again. Vala running for her life from a shielded Sonya. So very aggressive play and shot calling from FSG here. Trying to take advantage of the weak early game Varian. Sonya and Karazim go to DPS down. The Immortal Leeming joining them while ETC and Tassadar attempt to defend their own. FSG win the first Immortal phase and have a decent shield for their troubles. The Immortal will fly to the top lane. However, with Molten Core on the side of the 85 DeLoreans, I don't think this first Immortal is going to get very much value. The first Immortals tend to be a little bit weak anyway, and when you combine it with Molten Core, they're really not going to get too much here. Maybe the front wall. I think that would be about the limit there. There's the Molten Core. Only Falstad and Sonya not in this fight as they duel in the bottom lane, making sure neither team loses any experience. So far, only the gate has gone down. Both towers standing. There goes the first tower down, and there goes the second tower. So that's about what you would expect. The front wall going down for the 85 DeLoreans. And FSG and the DeLoreans now posturing in this top lane. Vala caught a little far forward. There's the power slide. She is able to vault away and barely escape with her life. Now being forced to hearth back. Anytime you have Leeming on your team, you have to account for the resets. If Leeming can get a series of resets, she can completely turn a fight. So you really got to be aware of that if you're the 85 DeLoreans. FSG now posturing for the Bruisers, zoning away the DeLoreans. However, they will not have what they need to take it. ETC caught forward. Varian now does have his level 4 stun. The cow walks away. No worse for wear, though. Let's go ahead and check on this bottom lane. Sonya probably going to win this, and you can tell that she is. Falstad low on life. Sonya perfectly healthy, raring to go. So Sonya will slowly win this bottom lane. Falstad hunting around here, not quite sure where Sonya is, knowing he has to be very careful. In the meantime, both teams still posturing here at the top. Power slide. ETC, I think, was a little too low in life to do that. Zazu in trouble and gets away with 160 hit points. That was a very aggressive move for how low in life he was there. He was able to get away, but a very aggressive move for a hero that didn't have a whole lot in the way of health there. Both teams at level 7. Both teams going to their bruiser camps to make sure that there's pressure on the lane during the immortal phase, and the immortals will appear in the defensive positions for each side. This is where Leeming really gets a lot of mileage. She is going to be the best poke for either one of these teams, and she can do it from a pretty safe distance. So this positioning, I do think, favors FSG. They are now posturing to push with the Immortals, or just maybe see if they could catch... I'm sorry, not the Immortals, the Mercs. Instead, they were just seeing if they could catch somebody out. Sonya getting a little bit of damage there on the DeLoreans. Mercs, while Ragnaros was showing bottom. However, they have appeared now. Leeming looks like she's going to clear up the bottom lane while FSG defends their own Vala clearing top. So both teams doing some lane maintenance before they will return to the middle here and fight for these immortals. I'm really surprised. There it is. I was going to say, I'm surprised we haven't seen Dark Link try to poke down the DeLorean's immortal. There he goes. Power slide onto Halorin. He's too far forward, and the slowing beam. Halorin once again falls a little too far forward. This game will become a different game at level 10. However, the DeLorean's right now just trying to get there. Snag caught far forward again. Pre-cleanse to keep him away. Fighting under the immortal can be a dangerous proposition, but so far FSG doing a nice job of it. Forced back though with the low health bars. I wonder if we see FSG send somebody in the lane to maybe soak for that level 10 advantage. And they have. Sonya's in the bottom, posturing with Rhaegar. Rag is at the top. So both teams trying to get soak while also put pressure on the immortals. Vala's in a tough spot. She does vault away. And the movement speed from Rag. So FSG definitely winning this early immortal. They have almost burned down all of the DeLorean's immortals. The DeLorean's need to be aware though. And there's a stun into the stun into a spear by Sonya. DeLorean's need to be aware. FSG is going to get 10 any second now, and that will mean a hard disengage because they cannot fight without heroics. Sonya going to the top lane to ensure that FSG picks up level 10, and there they do. The DeLorean's already in full retreat. We have Force Wall from Tassadar. We've been seeing a lot more Archon lately. Mosh Pit from ETC. Disintegrate from Li Ming. I believe that's Wrath of the Berserker from Sonya. And Seven-Sided Strike from Karazim. FSG will assuredly secure the second immortal of the game for them. However, Tens are here for the DeLoreans. We have Taunt for Varian, Reign of Vengeance from Vala, and they got the pick on the Li Ming. That was off camera. Nice job by the DeLoreans to get that. It looks like Sulfurous Smash was on cooldown, so that was certainly part of that kill. Gust from Falstad, Ancestral Healing from Rhaegar, and Sulfurous Smash from Ragnaros. Once again, Ragnaros will be a big part of this defense. Sonya has been left in the top lane, and now she is rotating down. There's the Molten Core to stunt this advance as much as possible. Reign of Vengeance goes out, hits no one. The shield has been burnt by the Immortal. Now about three quarters life. A lot of damage from Molten Core. Double stun from Rag and Varian. We have a running fight here. Falstad is top. There's the one-man, two-man mosh pit with the seven-sided strike. However, only Rag goes down. And now Falstad has flown down. There's the stun by Varian, but he will be isolated out by the Force Wall. Follow-up, Power Slide, and the Face Melt. Varian goes down one more time. So they were able to secure the bottom fort, and now an aggressive invasion with two members of the DeLoreans down. I really like this call from FSG. They just simply don't have the manpower to contest this, and they secure the Bruiser Camp on the DeLorean side of the map. So FSG looking very strong here in games 2 and 3. It looks like Sonya will go top to maybe solo the Bruiser, while the rest of his team goes to pick up this bottom Bruiser Camp. However, with Sonya showing top, we have a hard rotation here. All members of the DeLoreans on deck. However, Snag gets caught too far forward and picked off with the Force Wall isolation there. That was a good idea from the DeLoreans. However, the FSG was there. They were waiting for him, and Force Wall ETC caught Rag too far from his team, and they were able to get the pick there. FSG in control of this game right now. All of the Merc camps are on their side, currently pushing around the map. They have the one level advantage, 6-1 as well. So everything coming up red right now. And getting two Merc camps will be pushing in this top lane just as the Immortal spawn. So 85 DeLoreans back on their heels. Now they have to decide, do they clear double Merc camps or do they contest the Immortal? And being down a talent tier, they have to clear those Merc waves in the top, and they're going to seed forfeit the first half of this Immortal battle. Vala is very aggressive right there. She needs to be really careful with all members of FSG here. They still haven't cleared out all the Mercs in the top lane, and 85 DeLoreans Immortal already at half health. So the DeLoreans fighting 12 to 13. They are going to have to try to defend as best they can. They did manage to clear out all the Mercs in the top lane, though, and we will see how this team fight goes. With the Varian Sulfura Smash combo ready to go, they only need to land one, and maybe they get a pick that changes this fight around. ETC initiates onto the Varian, then isolated with the Force Wall. Seven-sided strike onto Rag. Ancestral will bring him back up. Leeming is taunted. Tassadar caught in the stun. FSG on a full retreat. Aggressive gust there from Alathanas. Man, this is a running team fight all over the place. A lot of damage going out, but nobody dying. Haloran is so low on Varian. The Tun, it's Daunt, and then Sonya mops him up. The first kill of a running team fight there. Initiation onto Tassadar. I really think that double support with the Karazhan Tassadar was the difference there. Ragnaros taken out there. However, both Karazhan and Tassadar fell in that, and Falstad able to fly away. So ultimately, that really long drawn out team battle ended up being a 2-4-2. However, 85 DeLorean spawn timers are much lower and they will be up sooner. They are here in force. FSG needs to be careful right here. Ton of damage going on to ETC. He is forced into full retreat. So they are able to secure the center part of the map. However, no damage going on to FSG's Immortal here. And we're going to have another 5-on-5 engagement here in a minute. Vala has transitioned onto FSG's Immortal while all four members are trying to defend here for the DeLoreans. Double power slide, and two members of the DeLoreans caught in the seven-sided strike. Sonk on Rhaegar barely gets away. Haloran barely gets away. He was down to 15 hit points. Still going strong. So low for the DeLoreans. Haloran was down to 15 hit points, and he barely got away. Full retreat for the DeLoreans. In the meantime, Vala did everything she could to burn down the shields. However, the third Immortal will once again go to FSG, and they will go to the top lane to push this out. This top fort is most definitely going to fall. I'm not sure if they're going to get here in time to try to defend it or not. Both teams have all of their heroics up, except for Wrath, which is going to be up in about 10 seconds. There goes the Rag Molten Core. They're going to stunt this offense as much as possible. All members accounted for, both teams on even talent tiers, another 5-on-5 engagement. Haloran isolated out, FSG really working that Force Wall, ETC, 7-sided isolation. They've run that a number of times, and poor Haloran is just getting punished because they are picking on him. As the most forward member, they isolate him out and hit him with the 7-sided. It's really working well for FSG here. Now with their eyes set on this keep, level 16 advantage, talent tier advantage, FSG full offense. Alathanas forced to burn Gust to hit a reset on that engagement, but this keep is certainly going down. 85 DeLoreans on their back foot, all structures up and ready for FSG. They decide to against the invasion, or are they invading? It looks like they are invading here. However, both supports are a little bit late. Oh, Sulfurous Smash comes so close to taking out Sonya. Tassadar low. I think that was some indecision on the part of FSG. They thought about it and then changed their mind, but Tassadar and Monk were both late to that engagement and ends up going their way. But that was definitely the level difference there. If that was even levels there, I really think that the DeLoreans would have won that engagement, and probably two members, Sonya and Tassadar, very well could have gone down on an even level engagement there. So once again, FSG is going to capture all these Merc camps, continuing to put the pressure on the DeLoreans. I think we're going to have three Merc camps go to FSG, while only one is going to be picked up by the DeLoreans. It looks like with the talent tier advantage, FSG is calling for the invade here. Both supports not there yet. They're checking. Now they know they're here. It looks like the DeLoreans, wary of fighting 17 to 15 and knowing Tassadar has vision, waiting. So two Merc camps, one in each lane, already pushing out against the DeLoreans. FSG very patiently waiting. They decide to simply go on the Immortal, knowing that that the DeLoreans have to deal with double Mercs pushing. And once again, this halftime is going to be over before it starts. FSG absolutely burning down this Immortal, and it is already half den. However, ETC caught very far forward. He does go with the Mosh Pit into seven-sided. However, ETC too far forward. Maybe the break that the DeLoreans needed. Ancestral keeps Rag going. Karazim gets killed on the backside, and for the first time this game, FSG in retreat, and they haven't lost halftime yet. One member is going to have to go back to do some housekeeping. Looks like it's going to be Falstad. Vala is already on the Immortal, while the rest of the DeLoreans look to defend as best they can, even eating the Li Ming damage, do everything they can to keep this Immortal up. However, they do burn the rest of that half health. However, those two kills have caught the DeLoreans up. They are now only a single level down, not a talent tier. There's the stun taunt onto Li Ming. However, her teleport took Haloran way too far forward, and he was isolated by the force wall. That charge on Varian will follow everybody to the ends of the earth, and when Li Ming teleported away, he just got taken too far out of position. And a nice force wall by Neuroterran isolated him out. So once again, FSG, despite the temporary setback, able to resume control of the battlefield. And DeLoreans here on their back foot. Good gust to keep Ragnaros alive. However, every Immortal this game has gone to FSG, and this one will be no different. So very soon here, the DeLoreans will be on their Alamo, their last stand. Heroic defense in, doing everything they can to try to save the core. They're not there yet, but they do have a wall, two turrets, in addition to Molten Core. So they're not in a terrible spot for defense, but they're running out of these opportunities here. They cannot give up another Immortal after this one. All members of the DeLoreans are here. Rhaegar just making his way down. Molten Core has popped, and FSG scattering, making sure they don't take all that AoE damage. Full strength Immortal still. That's the shield isn't down yet. The Molten Core is dead. There's the Mosh Pit. Haloran was cleansed away. Seven-sided didn't get much value, and the Gust. So four heroics used there. Not much to show for it for either team. However, the Taunt Sulfurous Smash combo finally bears fruit, taking out Karazim and then Sonya shortly thereafter. So great defense there for the 85 DeLoreans. They will live to fight another day. However, all of their keeps are down, and they are definitely in dire straits here. They need to win every team fight from here on forward if they're going to have any chance to win this game. All of FSG's structures are up, and they're already working on more pressure to put on the DeLoreans here. So let's see how much the DeLoreans can capitalize on the two deaths. They're probably not going to be able to put too much pressure on FSG. It's really going to be about relieving the pressure that they're under. These lanes are just pushed so far, and there's always Merc camps on the board in favor of FSG. It just makes it very difficult for the DeLoreans, and it looks like they're going to try to put some pressure on this bottom fort. That's going to be tough, though. All members of FSG up. FSG is level 20, and they are rotating down in force. They do are able to take it out, though. Now in full retreat, they want to make sure they don't get caught. Halloran given the speed boost by Rag. There's the Sonya initiate, and there's the Gust disengage. Nice job by Alathanas. So, the DeLoreans finally able to get something in their favor, using those two kills and cash them in for a fort. And this top wave will probably secure them 20. So these teams will both be at level 20 for what is sure to be. Nope. FSG is having none of it. Oh, completely missed Mosh Pit. Then he eats a Rain of Vengeance. He's taunted. Halloran gets an Ancestral to keep him alive. The seven-sided doing a ton of damage. ETC very low. Both sides popping Storm Shields. A lot of damage going out there, though. Karazim very far forward. Dashes in, dashes out. Now both sides look like they will be disengaging. So a lot of heroics down for both sides. However, Rain is going to be up soon. Gust is going to be up soon. It looks like the only ones that won't be up shortly are Mosh Pit and Ancestral Healing and Sulfurous Smash not up as well. Aggressive posturing from the DeLoreans here. Once again, Halloran caught double, triple stunned. That stun from the Immortal was brutal there. Nikita caught out on Vala, and this might be the beginning of the end for the DeLoreans. They are under a ton of pressure, two members down. I'm not sure what they're going to do here. FSG showing a lot of patience. They're opting not to go too aggressive and just get this Immortal. They know that securing this Immortal will probably secure the game. We have 40 seconds before Vala and Varian will be up, and that's just too much time. I'm not quite sure what the DeLoreans can do here. I mean, you really can't fight 3-on-5, but you also can't let them get this Immortal either, so they're doing what best they can, stall this out. Ragnaros is caught pretty far forward. The seven-sided is waiting for him. Nice Gust by Alathanas once again. Alathanas has had to use Gust defensively this whole game. We've really only seen one offensive Gust about mid-game. Otherwise, it's been all about the disengage. And then there goes Ragnaros. Leeming gets her reset. However, Vala and Varian are up. This will be a 5-on-4 for the defense here. And barring something miraculous, I think this is going to be all she wrote for the DeLoreans. They have their backs against the wall. They're going to be fighting under their core. And they're in a lot of trouble here. Down a man. 5v4. This is the heroic last stand for the DeLoreans here. FSG has shown a lot of patience this game. They're not rushing anything. Alathanas needs to be careful. He's pretty far forward here. 18 seconds till Ragnaros is up. I don't think he will be here in time. FSG just simply waiting for the Immortal to walk in and start tanking the core. There's ETC stunned, taunted, a lot of damage. Halloran taking a lot of damage as well. Seven-sided catches three people in there, so nobody burnt down. Ancestral keeps Halloran up. Great 5v4, and Karazim the first to fall. However, there's the Mosh Pit, is able to secure the kill on Falstad. Both Rhaegar and Ragnaros in there. We haven't seen Molten Core yet. You wonder if he can get over there. ETC falls too, but the Death Metal secures another kill and secures the game. Great, really entertaining game there. Entertaining set overall, and FSG able to take the set 2-1 after falling behind. So really bouncing back in game 2 and 3. Securing their victory here against the 85 DeLoreans. So thanks to everybody for tuning in, and thanks to the teams for hanging out a little bit late. I know my first set ran a little long, and I appreciate them hanging out for about 10 minutes so I could cast the game for them. Hope everybody enjoyed it. Have a wonderful evening. We'll be back Thursday for a couple more Chair League games, so be sure to tune in then. Have a wonderful night, all.